shoulder. Step back! That's a
the ball and can choose to pitch it to another back. It's an option play. Ryan?
Football 400.
I can tell you guys are big football fans.
Yeah.
Tom Landry perfected the shotgun formation with this team. Dallas Cowboys. Do you think we should go to commercial? Ryan?
Take it on to 600.
Okay, by signaling for one of these, a returner can reel in a kick without fear of getting tackled. Fair catch. Two clues left, Ryan.
800.
These penalties are simultaneous violations by the offense and defense that cancel each other out. And they are called offsetting penalties. Let's look at the $1,000 clue, just for the fun of it. Jimmy?
As Minneapolis's U.S. Bank Stadium prepares to host Super Bowl 52, I'm looking at the Ring of Honor with names from this defensive line that took the Vikings to four Super Bowls.
If you guys ring in and get this one, I will die. Who are the Purple People Eaters? We're going to take a break. I have to talk to them.
You know, I just realized that the end of that clip, I guess the timing might not have been good to play the full clip as he made that joke about passing away. Mm-hmm. So welcome into Mitten Sports Talk right here on Sports Radio Detroit as we are back after a couple weeks off. And we played that clip, as I'm sure all of you have heard by now. Alex Trebek has been diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer, which is one of the worst news that any human being can hear from their doctor, as his odds are not in his favor, and he's being very positive about it, and that's great. And a lot of doctors say you should take it well, obviously they want you to take it positively, but he says he's going to continue to host Jeopardy, which is cool, and a lot of doctors agree that you should continue to work and live your normal life, which has got to be very hard, especially when you're Alex Trebek. You're a millionaire, a multimillionaire. You know, you've been hosting Jeopardy since NOM. You know, you could easily ride off in the sunset and go stick your head in the sand somewhere and, you know, drink the rest of your life away. But, you know, I don't know. I don't watch Jeopardy a whole lot, as I'm sure both of you don't really as well.
I do. I mean, I grew up watching. I do.
Hi, everyone.
I get a kick out of it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And Alex Trebek is a legend in his own right. And, you know, he's been hosting Jeopardy since 84. He's got 5 Emmys. He holds the record for most game show episodes hosted. He took over from Bob Barker with that. But yeah, patients diagnosed at stage 4 live an average of 12 to 15 months. He said he wants to keep hosting Jeopardy.
I have the audio if you want me to play it. If you want me to. All right.
Hi, everyone. I have some news to share with all of you, and it's in keeping with my longtime policy of being open and transparent with our Jeopardy fan base. I also wanted to prevent you from reading or hearing some overblown or inaccurate reports regarding my health. So therefore, I wanted to be the one to pass along this information. Now, just like 50,000 other people in the United States each year, this week I was diagnosed with stage 4 pancreatic cancer. Now, normally the prognosis for this is not very encouraging, but I'm going to fight this, and I'm going to keep working, and with the love and support of my family and friends, and with the help of your prayers also, I plan to beat the low survival rate statistics for this disease. Truth told, I have to, because under the terms of my contract, I have to host Jeopardy for 3 more years. So help me, keep the faith, and we'll win. We'll get it done. Thank you.
So, yeah, and he's definitely not wrong. Statistics show about 91% of pancreatic cancer patients die within 5 years of diagnosis. So he's definitely not wrong about the odds being not in his favor. And, you know, it's just sad. You know, he's been on the air for a long time. You know, Jeopardy is a show that a lot of people probably don't watch religiously, but, you know, like you guys said, it's something you catch every once in a while, and you got a guy like Trebek who's a pro, you know, and he does have his moments of humor where he messes with the contestants. So it's definitely sad to hear.
That speech, by the way, is very empowering. Mm-hmm. And very – I got choked up because the – be in that situation to deal with that and to have that kind of composure. He's always been a very even keel guy, unlike myself, which I demonstrated earlier on the road show. But to have that kind of composure to go out there and say that, I mean, do we know if he did it more than once, a couple takes, you know, but still.
And to do it in the same voice, like as he went hosting the show, yeah. I thought that was great. You know, but yeah, so obviously, you know, everybody here from SRD, we hope for the best for Mr. Trebek. So,
absolutely.
Off with some sad news, as this is kind of a sad show because I am back in the wonderful state that we live in.
Well, that's Michigan. Not sad.
Yeah, that's not sad.
Well, to you guys,
we missed you.
But for myself, after spending a week in Florida, which God, that'll just change your mindset on life, but. But yeah, it big change, you know. It was 75 every day. It was sunny most days. I might have hit a pothole or two the entire week. I hit more potholes on my drive to the studio today, which, you know, spoiler alert for those of you who don't know, I live about half mile from this place, so I don't even live that far. And yeah, it was definitely a great time with the girlfriend's family. So. But yeah, it sucks being back here. And it was snowing the very first day I got back, and it was cold, and it's still cold, and it still sucks. So I'm without a doubt a warm weather person, 100%. I hate the cold, and I hate it more and more each year. So it was nice to get out of here for a week, and it was nice when I came back because I had originally thought that I only got 1 week of PTO for 2019. And so, you know, going into the trip, I knew fair and well, that you know, or at least I thought that was going to be my only PTO time for the year, and I was going to use it in the 1 week, the second month of the year. And then when I came back, I'm on this committee at work, and we were talking, and apparently I have another week. So
nice
silver lining there.
I have 3 weeks of PTO when my 90s kick in. Yeah. Not to be a humble brag. Well, I actually did a humble brag, so I apologize.
Kind of go fuck yourself.
Whatever. don't hate the player, hate the game.
I do hate the game. But the other great part about coming back to work was going through my 1,800 emails I had. Mm. One of them was at work, we are now part of this program where we get discounts on tickets to theme parks, including Universal Studios, Disney World, and all that. So while I was down in Florida going to Universal Studios and theme parks and attractions, I received an email that I actually get discounts to those places. And I did not know that. And so I went up for point, which is not their fault.
I know you're down there, like, kicking yourself, though, like, I mean, you know, if we just pushed it back one more week. Like, just one more week.
And then you're like, and then he's doing that, the budget, the counting in his head, Lance, you know, like that classic, like, numbers moving back and forth kind of thing.
Yeah.
Well, and I think the email was sent out on, like, Thursday or Friday, so I was already, like, you know, in the home stretch of the vacation. But the other part would be like, God damn it. Like, that's where you hope, you know, if that email is sent out, like, Monday, you would hope your coworkers would have the awareness and the respect to maybe text you. Because
yes.
I don't have the email on my phone. So maybe they would have the awareness to, like, hey, Jeremy's in Florida. I know you mentioned about going to the theme parks. Maybe we should text them. But no.
They were probably upset that they were still at work.
Right.
You're out so out of spite. 75 degree weather, two yeah. potholes.
Yeah. So out of spite, they probably weren't going to text me either way.
Let them figure it out.
But all right. So we got a lot to talk about here, and it's. I did not expect today to go the way that it did, so I thought that I really wouldn't have talked much at all today, but I actually had to sub in on Pearson's piece on Brian's show. I had to fill in to run the board, and then due to lack of attendance on the road show, Roger asked me to substitute in.
I really appreciate that, honestly.
Oh, no problem. No problem. So I've already said a lot today, but that's okay.
Lance and I can carry the show.
Yeah. No, you guys did a good job at that anyway. So where to start?
Well, by the way, there is a – I don't know if you guys saw this or not, but I thought they'd bring this up really quickly before we get into sports, that there is a bill being introduced that would end the Michigan time change for daylight savings time because that's going on tomorrow.
I did see that, and I just kind of breezed through the article, and I – you know, there's – the way that the House, the state representative that is sponsoring the bill describes it as it's kind of you. I feel like you have to do a little more research yourself on it because, you know, they talk about how there's medical reasons why they want to get rid of daylight savings time, you know, because it kind of messes with your internal clock and all that. So you would need more statistics and more research to do, but just face value, I think it's a stupid idea. The other 47 other states do it. You might as well just.
Do you think there's any medical proof behind it, Lance?
Other than just being irritating, which is not medical proof at all. There's a part of me that wants to understand it, but I just can't get it for the life of me. Like, why push me one way or the other? You know, time.
Yeah, there's never been a concrete, logical explanation for it.
Right.
Yeah.
And, you know, I just don't get it personally. If anybody does understand, like, I'd love to hear, like, why we even do it in the first place, but...
You can call in at 313-879-5059. So there you go. Hopefully we'll get a daylight savings time enthusiast to call in. And
I will say this. I am excited to have more daylight, though. You know.
Oh, 100%.
More daylight. 100%. It's starting to smell like, you know, grass. And
yeah.
Baseball weather.
100%. And this past week, as I have come back to the great state of Michigan, I have noticed that, like, hey, a little later and later, mm-hmm. you know, it's staying light out. And on my drive home, there's not this beaming light shining into my eyes.
Yeah.
So that's always nice because I can actually see when I'm driving on I-94, which seeing is a pretty large requirement on that highway. But
in terms of also, I mean, I'm sure you were seeing the sunshine down there, but what you missed really is the whole tax situation that came up with the new governor proposing that, people flipping out, and then people saying, well, actually, our taxes for gas isn't that bad across the United States.
Well, and that ties in perfectly because where I was at in Florida, they have the toll roads, you know, which could supplement that and sort of take over for, you know, upping the gas tax. Because, toll roads... quite a few states are starting to use them. And we, you know, Michigan is a state that we could definitely use them. You know, you have two interstates in this state that you get a lot of non-local traffic driving through. I-94, you know, coming from Canada, it goes right to Chicago. And then you have I-75, which goes all the way up and down our state. It goes all the way down to Florida. So you have a lot of non-local traffic that drives on those interstates that could easily, you know, pay some money every time they use it, and we could use that to help fix the roads because the roads are terrible. I mean, we don't need to rehash that. Everybody knows the roads are terrible. It's just finding a way to fix it, and I understand, you know, upping the tax would help that, but how much would it help that, you know, in the long run?
Here's what my question would be this. Say you up the tax, but you're still using crappy materials to continue to, you know, put Band-Aids on bullet wounds, which is really what they're doing. You know, what they're filling these roads with is absolute garbage as to why they keep having to do it. You know, like, would it be beneficial for us to take the hit for a couple years, you know, pay the high taxes and actually get some, you know, better materials for the roads? Yes. Like, as soon as you cross certain state lines, you notice a drastic change in the roads. Drastic change. Like, what's stopping us from using better material? And it might sound a little nearsighted, but, like, the patchwork, the new pavement, it's all crummy to me.
Right.
Now, again, this is just my opinion, but if we're going to even consider tax increases, how's it going to show it to be beneficial to us? Like, what's the real reason why we're going to do it? Not just we need new roads, but, okay, what direction are we going now?
Right. And I, to go along with that, I mean, Ohio's right next to us, and a lot of people say Ohio's roads are way better. Ohio gets just as cold as us. They get snow like us.
Yes.
You know, yes, we probably have more semi-truck traffic just from Canada, mm-hmm. but I'm with you. I just don't understand.
And you could argue that Ohio takes forever to do construction on their highways and things like that, but
that's
once they actually finish certain segments of those highways, like, you don't run into issues.
No. And Ohio also has toll roads.
Yeah, they do. Yes, and they do. That Cedar Point, by the way, that stretch between 280 before you get to Cedar Point, I kid you not, I feel like that's been under construction since I was in high school. Right. Like, I really, it has not. I know there was that bridge they built, there was a couple of deaths, mm-hmm. which I think that's why the construction was slowed down a little bit, but that stretch between 280, I think 75 to 280, right before you get to the turnpike, that has been forever. I'm not kidding, Jeremy. Even probably since the time you were born, it's been under some sort of level of, like, being worked on constantly.
And I know there's a spot not far from where the Mud Hens play. You know, it's like you get to – there's a car plant right off, you know, on the right side of the freeway, headed south. And it just seems like there's always construction and, you know, detours, and this, that, and the third. But then I have all faith that once they're complete, you won't see any construction or detours for a long time. I don't know what material they're using. I don't know what the processes are. But it's not like it's any warmer in Ohio than it is here.
Right.
You know, it's not like the traffic. Like you said, the weighted traffic for the trucks may make a difference. But, you know, that runs right through Michigan, Metro Detroit.
Right.
Runs right through. So I'm curious to see, you know, what a tax increase would really bring us. You know, if they don't lay anything out for us.
Right. Right. And, yeah, and I mean, the semi-trucks do play a part, but at the same mm-hmm. time, like, look at the roads that just – look at your local roads, not even, like, I-94 or I-75 or 696, whatever. Like, look at your local roads. Your local roads are trash. Mm-hmm. Like, and it's not like semis are, you know, going up and down those all day, you know, coming from the Ambassador Bridge or something. Like, exactly. So, no, and I believe Eric, who – is our construction consultant on this show. I believe he has mentioned before that, yes, it's more about the material we use. We don't use the best material. It's more of like the metaphor you use, you're putting a Band-Aid on a bullet hole. So, but no, it's, you know, I don't know. We'll see if it works, I guess. I mean, you know, I applaud her enthusiasm to fix the roads, but living in Michigan, as long as we all have, all three of us, and driving on the roads as long as we all have, mm-hmm. I definitely think all three of us are kind of in that, I'll believe when I see it.
Yeah, I've driven on better dirt roads, like, you know.
It'd be better if some of the roads were dirt roads.
I mean, you'd probably save on taxes. At least you know what you're getting, right?
Right.
Hey, real fast, I did a little research on this daylight savings time, and consistently across the board, the excuse, or the purpose, I should say, not excuse, is to make better use of daylight. So I would imagine that, you know, some people who own some big corporations was like, hey, what's a way that we can kind of get more work out of our
Well, and the big thing here to go with that, and it says that in that article, that the people, one of the group of people most that would be pissed if that bill passed would be golf courses and ski yes. resorts. They yes. would be pissed if that.
Yes, cause that's times at 7. And, oh, boy, you're going to lose hours.
Yeah.
Money.
Yeah, hours ago, money.
Money.
So, and if it don't make dollars, it don't make sense. So,
Jeremy with the freestyle.
Right.
Yeah. Break it down. Break it down, stovetop.
So, yeah. So, no, yeah. Golf courses and ski resorts, which obviously are very big here in the state of Michigan, yeah, they're not going to be happy about that if that passes. Personally, I don't think it'll pass. But I also kind of don't care. I'm just, to me, it's like, we've been doing it so long, 95% of the rest of the country does it. Why not just keep on keeping on? You know, hey, if they did decide to change it and it's stuck for a while, would we all get used to it?
Sure.
Yeah. Like, it's not like it's a huge thing that would change your entire life or your entire schedule. You'd still go to work 9 to 5, whatever hours you work. You know, it's not, it wouldn't really change anything for the most part. So, and it's not, you know, obviously we have very drastic winter, so it's not like, it's not like if that changed, you're going to be outside playing in the snow more. You know, like we're all grown-ass people. So, but, all right. So, a couple things that I just kind of want to touch on that, that we kind of missed while I was gone. The trade deadline came and gone for the NHL, and the Red Wings got rid of Nick Jensen. They traded him to the Washington Capitals for, I believe, a second-round pick. And then the Capitals ended up re-signing or extending him, so the Red Wings can no longer re-sign him in the offseason like it was proposed. That's whatever. I'm not really going to complain about that too much just because, you know, Nick Jensen was a above-average defenseman. He was a solid defenseman, but he probably was never going to turn into anything that great. He was already like 27 years old or something. He wasn't exactly that young. Mm-hmm. Red Wings have a lot of young defensemen. You're seeing one right now, Hronik play, and Hronik looks pretty good. Damn good.
Yeah.
So that's not too big a deal. You know, you never know, I guess. You'll never find out what the market was, but not trading guys like Vanek and Jimmy Howard, that is a little upsetting just because, you know, Jimmy Howard might have got you a first-round pick, maybe. But even at that, a second-round pick's not the worst thing in the world. You know, Gus Nyquist, you know, he got traded to San Jose as well, so that was a good move by Ken Holland.
Was that for a second as well?
I believe that was also for a second. And I think that one has the ability to become a first if they make the finals or if he re-signs with them. So that was a good move by Ken Holland, so one plus there. And then Thomas Vanek, you know, he's not having the year that we all hoped he would. He's obviously very old as well. So all in all, not the worst trade deadline for Ken Holland. He's doing what he can. You know, and like I said, who knows what the market was for Jimmy Howard. But, yeah, the Red Wings are moving in the right direction. That direction is towards, you know, the bottom of the standings. I believe they're second to last still. They're a few points ahead of Ottawa. But still, I mean, I believe if you finish dead last, your chance of getting the top pick is like 18.5%. If you finish second, it's 13.5%. So not a huge difference, but you want to finish last. So hopefully they can continue to make their way down. They have like 20 games left or something.
Do you feel like the Wings, or Holland in particular, is like really committed to the future now?
Yeah.
Because you figure for years it was like, again, let's just put somebody in this spot, or let's just get a name. Do you really feel like, you know, they've committed, like, hey, look, not so much tanking, but, you know, we got to let these young guys go. We got to let them play.
Yeah, I don't think they're going to ever kind of do tanking the way a lot of fans probably want them to. I don't think
or they're a radio host in town.
Right. That is true. I don't think they're ever going to do that. I think I don't want to say pride.
I was going to say that, though.
I think they're just a little too proud. Because you can tell they even kind of try to at least stay somewhat
they're
relevant.
Competitive, yeah.
Yeah, which is fine from their standpoint. But I definitely think they do realize, like, we got to focus on the future. We got to get draft picks. We got to do what we can to really make the future look a lot brighter. I mean, I believe in ESPN's farm system ranking that was released this week, they were like 9th or 10th, which isn't
not bad,
you know, but for being where you are in the standings, you'd like it to be a little bit, like it to be a little bit better, but no, not bad. And they have a lot of picks coming up in this draft, and they acquired some picks for next year's draft as well. So,
and it gives them flexibility if they do want to make moves. You know, you can trade some of those picks. So they're not in a bad spot, I don't think. But
no, and they'll be. I mean, if we're talking about for them to be competitive, from that standpoint, a lot of it I think is going to come down to what they do with Jimmy Howard. If they can re-sign Jimmy Howard, which it kind of sounds like both sides want to, that'll be big. Because if they don't re-sign Jimmy Howard, I don't know what the F they're going to do at goalie. Right. Like, they're going to have to sign somebody because Jonathan Bernier is not great, and they don't have that goalie prospect that is right there, willing, you know, waiting in the wings to, you know, to come up and show what he can do. They don't have that.
Right.
So they almost have to re-sign Jimmy Howard from a competitive standpoint, and even I don't think that's the worst idea. I would be all for re-signing Jimmy Howard. But how much better can they be next year? I don't think they'll be that much better. I mean, they might not be basement dwellers, but...
How far off you think they really are from... Not necessarily a cup, but just being in the mix.
Yeah, for a playoff spot, I would say at the least two. Like, next year I would say no, but the year after they could, because Cronwall comes off the books this year, and I pray to everything they don't resign him. I don't think he's
nothing surprises me anymore.
Well, right.
He's like Victor Martinez at the
Yes.
You love him, but it's like, it's time.
And you're starting to not love him because you know it's time.
No more, you got Cromwell. Because right. It's more like you got hit by a fly.
I think the bigger thing is, I think he's not going to want to come back. I think his body's just
torn up.
Yeah, and yeah. I think he's not going to want to come back. So there's some guys that kind of come off the books, and you'll have more room. And that's the thing. The Red Wings are not the Pistons. The Pistons have no cap flexibility. The Red Wings do. So maybe if they kind of kept that in their back pocket this offseason, open up some roster spots to let the young guys play fully next year, and then maybe that next year take some of that cap space and put it towards good use, you know, and then – You know, because next year, looking at it, you know, Mantha, Lark, and Anthony Seau, they'll have another year. One would think Zadina's going to be on the team next year. You'd almost kind of say he has to be, just from, you know, he's a number six pick. He's looked all right so far in the time he's been up here. And the Red Wings aren't – that's what the Red Wings used to be known for.
Lines.
Just, you know, draft a dude in the first round and stash him. Because we don't need him. Because we have Yzerman and Shanahan and Datsyuk and Zetterberg. You know, we don't need him right now. You're not really there anymore. Like, you kind of need Zadina to step up and be good, like, within the next year or two. So you would think Zadina's going to be on the roster next year with Cronwall gone. You hope Hirona can get in the lineup fully next year. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, and, you know, this isn't to, like, be a nervous person or, like, scare anybody, but... Hopefully Mike Green's okay, because he's got something wrong that sounds like that could kind of become something serious. So hopefully that virus or whatever he has is okay. But, yeah, so hopefully, you know, Hronik, Zadina, possibly, you know, Rasmussen should be, you know, more of a contributing factor next year. So I think next year they could be a little bit better. They might be contenders for, you know, wild card spot, you know, as you get down the stretch, but I don't think they'll make the playoffs next year. I think in a couple years, though, that could really be the year. I think, personally, I think the Red Wings are like a year or two ahead of the Tigers. Roger, from a Tiger, well, you're also a big Tigers fan. From like a Tiger standpoint, I don't know how far you guys think Tigers are from competing for a playoff spot.
I think the Wings are ahead of the curve ahead of the Tigers. And I can, you know me, I can look up the Tigers objectively. I think the Tigers are about 4 or 5 years away, honestly.
From competing for even making a wild card.
Yeah, only because here's why I say that. One, Franklin Perez, who they got from the Houston deal, it hasn't thrown. No. He's been injured again. Two, it's really it depends. I'll say this only by minimum because right now it depends on what they get out of this draft class and the 2018 draft class. If they can't get two or three guys that can come up and make an impact. If they can, then I'll move it up a year, maybe it'll move up 2 years, three years tops. But if they have nothing that comes out of this class again, you're screwed because you're expecting your depth to come up and help, and you're keeping prospects around. Lugo is terrible, can't draw walks. That's why they had to bring in Josh Harrison, and they even picked up another utility guy on the cheap. They're doing everything cost effective right now. Three, even look at the outfield situation. Jacoby Jones.
What outfield situation?
Well, what outfield? Jacoby Jones, great defensively, has struggled. You know, Mackie Mocktuk is, you know, hitting
crap. Serviceable player.
But serviceable, but he's not your future outfielder. No. Christian Stewart's quietly having a really good spring. Mm-hmm. That's hopeful. So that gives that, but defensively, I mean, he's not a good thrower. He's less than serviceable, but his bat will speak for itself. And that's a future DH right there.
Where is he batting in the lineup?
I think, I want to say towards the middle, like five or six or something. Right? Yeah, something like that. So you look at the outfield depth right now. Outside of that, you have Robson in Toledo. Dustin Peterson, you don't know what he is. Is it Peterson? Yeah. You don't know what you have in him, but...
What about Brock Deathridge?
Same.
I was going to say Brock Lesnar.
Yeah. It depends on what happens in Lakeland. I mean, your pitching depth is where the Tigers will... That's going to play the strength, but the rest of the infield is kind of a mystery.
Yeah.
They have Winciel Perez, who did really well last year, but now this year you're going to see a full, you know, a slate of him. A guy that I brought up on the podcast, and Chris and I talked about, Anzano Gonzalez. That's a shortstop, third baseman, big, thick body, who Tigers have this tendency to draft shortstops and second baseman, you know, that look malnourished some strange reason. But if they can't get any of the infield or outfield to get going, that's why I say 5 years, because you need those players to have that depth to come up and make an impact, because they don't have enough impact bats right now in their system. They really don't. And that's saying something that Christian Stewart, it took him a while to get there, but they have a lot of fourth outfielders, a lot of 4A players, but they don't really have, you know, Perez maybe, but outside of that, there's nothing that really excites, and that's going to take some time to build.
No, and that's the one thing. You look at the Tigers, you know, future and what you're hopeful for. I mean, you can look at the starters, and it's like, okay, you know, Manning, Burrows, Fajardo, Mize, Funkhauser. You know, you got some guys on there that you can be very, very hopeful for, but you're right. When it comes to the positional players, it's like, who? You know, who's really going to – who can you look at now and kind of be excited about? Yeah, Daz Cameron and Christian Stewart are a couple names that, like, yeah, you can get a little behind right now, but – You know. I know, Roger, one of your favorite bits is Cody Clemens, you know, how he's the next coming. And, you know, people need to relax on that. But didn't they draft, like, a Meadows outfielder? Was the name Meadows?
Yeah. Parker Meadows has got some potential to him, but he hasn't really – we haven't seen enough to him.
Like, super young?
Yeah, he's –
18, 19.
There's Kingston Liniac.
I have to look them up.
Yeah, Kingston Liniac's another outfielder, a young outfielder that Baseball America and a lot of people are high on.
That's another great name, by the way.
Kingston Liniac?
Yeah.
That is a pretty sweet name. It's not like, you know, something like, was it Austin or Noah? Like, that seems like the big trendy millennial names right now.
Liniac.
Yeah.
No, it's a good name. Tigers are doing pretty good in the name category. I mean, Brock Deathridge probably leads the clubhouse. I mean, you can't really beat that. but yeah, the Red Wings, I don't think they're quite that far away. The Red Wings' biggest problem, if you're talking like future and prospects, they just don't have a goalie. You know, like outside of Jimmy Howard, that's really it. And Jimmy Howard's 34, 5. So, I mean, obviously he's getting close to being, you know, not very good. So they have a couple of like really young defensemen. They have a couple of really young forwards. The Red Wings' biggest problem going forward is going to be like a superstar, like especially on defense too. They need to find like that true number one defenseman, and whether that's Roenick or the Sar Javari guy or the McIsaac, another guy they have in juniors, like whether it's one of them, that's fine, but they have not had that solidified like number one defenseman since basically Nick Lidstrom. So, you know, up front, Larkin is a superstar, you know, Mantha could be, you know, Anthony, he's a really good player. Zadina, who knows, he's young, Jerry's still out. But, yeah, the Red Wings are definitely a little closer than the Tigers. But and then you got the Pistons, who just, I don't know. I know we talked a lot about that on the road show, and I know I sound like the, you know, the pessimistic person about this.
I was just going to ask you, like, are you excited about this?
No, I'm not.
About the Pistons? About the Pistons, really?
Yeah, I'm not. And it's just,
it's actually hard to watch still, though. You know what I mean? Like, they're putting themselves in a position to maybe make a little playoff push. But it's like, it's nothing to get excited about, is it?
No, you that's know? The thing. They're only like a game and a half up on the ninth place team. So it's not even like they've solidified
that line mostly all season, right?
Right, and they're in a really good stretch right now. I believe
I do like this, and I was talking with my dad about it. I like that they seem to have taken the ball out of Blake's hand, you know, when coming up the court. And it seems like it's opening the floor for everybody else, it's getting more people involved.
Yeah, and Luke Kennard's played really well.
Luke has been playing great over the last couple weeks.
Yeah, Luke Kennard's been playing really well.
Stay there, keep an eye out, see if you can find out where those troops are housed.
Right.
Well, what do you think, Oddball?
It's a wasted trip, baby. Nobody said nothing about locking horns with no Tigers.
Hey, look,
You just keep those Tigers busy and we'll take care of the rest.
The only way I got to keep them Tigers busy is to let them shoot holes in me.
We just want you to keep them interested for a while, that's all.
Oh, man, you guys are crazy. Look, when we was in a Bocage country, we was assaulted by them Tigers. You know what I mean by assaulted, huh? Well, I mean assaulted.
Why don't you knock it off with them negative waves? Why don't you dig how beautiful it is out here? Why don't you say something righteous and hopeful for a change?
Sorry.
It's a long way to get to what I was trying to say, but essentially, yeah.
But,
Tigers.
But, well, right, because I'm thinking, is he trying to tell us something about the Tigers? Or
like, be a negative.
Because we just talked about it. But no, I don't know. No, I'm not excited about this at all. Because I know, like, if they get to the playoffs, what difference does it make? Like, okay, they play Indiana. Mm-hmm. Yes, they could win. Pro and Ravon are way more optimistic about it than I am. Because they believe that they could beat the Pacers in a series, which I don't. I don't think they'll beat the Pacers in a series. Sure, I think they could take it to six maybe yeah. seven. But, like, I don't think they're going to beat the Pacers. I don't think you're going to beat anybody in a series. Like, in Milwaukee, Boston, I think you'd get swept. Toronto, I think you'd get swept.
Philly's
like kind of a wild card. Boston, I guess would be kind of. I mean, I can see taking a game from those two, but that's not the point. And like Greg Kelser said, like, oh, if they win a playoff game, that'd be progress. They haven't done that in 10 years. But like, who cares though? Nobody cares if you win a playoff game. A lot of times when a team wins 4-1, nobody looks at it like that because like, oh, you won the pity game. Four at home right. that the other team wasn't trying.
Came out with a lot of emotion.
I know, and I get what you guys are both being negative. And here's the thing. I'm very cynical when it comes to sports, in a lot of things. But the reason why I'm encouraged about this is the reason why Indiana has done a lot without Oladipo out. That's pretty impressive what they've been able to do. However, you're burning your starting five quite a bit. I think this, the reason why I think it's progress in any way, shape, or form is what we have with Stan Van Gundy has been absolute atrocious.
Yes.
So for this to come out of what's been happening since the Stanley Johnson trade, since Reggie Jackson's kind of fully healthy a little bit, to get Blake Griffin at probably, arguably, and like I said this earlier, about putting a team on his back and getting that over, like, Pistons haven't had that since Grant Hill. Pistons, I mean, when the going to work era was a combination of Chauncey Billups, Richard Hamilton off screens, doing well, playing off the ball, and that was a total teamwork. But Blake Griffin to just carry it, like, I remember Grant Hill almost had to get a triple-double every night to even get the Pistons over the hump.
Yeah,
I mean, your starting center was Don Effin Reed, for Christ's sake. So that's, and for any Pistons fan at home to know that's come a long way. But the reason why I'm showing a little bit of optimism is because they've been, like, for the Pistons to make it, they have to start somewhere. I mean, if they win in a couple games in the playoffs or winning a series, that's starting something. It's starting something that they haven't had since their Eastern Conference Finals run.
Yeah.
So I will take that any day of the week versus, oh, well, we'll just have to tear it back down again. And they're capped. And they're extremely capped for what they can do. They're able to do what they're doing, how capped they are. I think that merits some sort of level of respect.
How much of this is finally buying into the new culture for Casey?
I think it has a lot to do with it. I think Casey, you know, Dwayne Casey set up what's going on in Toronto. He has set the table for what is going on with the Raptors.
Yeah.
And he deserves a lot of credit for that. And I think he does. I think he gets some credit for that. But they're buying into what he's doing because he has a pedigree. I think he got screwed Toronto a little bit only because DeMar Rosen wasn't going to be the guy that's going to get him over the hump. I'm sorry. DeRozan, they changed their game and it got better, but Toronto lacked a certain kind of toughness to him. Now they have that with Leonard. They were very aggressive at the trade deadline and in doing that, but they weren't really aggressive when Casey was there. So I think he did what he could with what he had. And he took Toronto from being like that team that, you know, but they're just Toronto to we're the North. He was part of that culture change. He was part of that whole what they're doing right there in Toronto. But I think that the Pistons are buying into it now because they're seeing results of it and Stan Van Gundy isn't here to kind of ride his horses or deal with Tom Gores. I think Stan Van Gundy took on more than he could chew being a GM. Mm-hmm. So,
okay, so I respect the whole they got to start somewhere, and they do. Like, every team's got to start somewhere. But the reason why it's hard for me to really buy into that is because, like you even kind of said, they are capped with what they can do, and that goes into next year too. They aren't going to have a lot of cap space. Even if they were to trade like Reggie Jackson in the offseason, they still wouldn't have much of that cap space. So it's like, that's why I have a hard time buying into this team and what they got going on right now, because it's like, okay, like, yeah, it's cute. You guys might make the playoffs and might not get swept. Like, But you also might not be any better next year. Like, it's not like, okay, yeah, you have Luke Kennard who's showing promise right now, but like, I just, outside of that, I mean, clearly, like, you're trying to make the playoffs, so you're not going to get too high of a draft pick. Mm-hmm. So, like, you are going to have to hit on that 16, 17, 18, whatever draft pick you get. Like, you're going to have to really hit on that pick. And because you can't go out and make a big splash in free agency. And we've talked about before about Detroit having, having their own struggles. All Detroit teams making splashes in free agency. So you don't even have the money to do it, let alone someone wanting to come here. What are people, okay, you try to trade Andre Drummond, you might get some value back for that because he's playing a little bit better now. But what are you really going to get back for, that would make you better in the future wise? And same with Reggie Jackson. Like, if you try to trade Reggie Jackson, you might just get someone else's bad contract, that might be expiring sooner than Reggie's. So, or you might get like a late first round pick or something. Who knows? But that's why I have a hard time buying in with this, because yes, it's nice and it's fun to see them like play well and make a run at the playoffs. But A, they're not going to get anywhere in the playoffs. And B, I don't even know if that's going to help them next year. If it's going to set anything up, it might hurt them next year because they won't have as high of a pick.
That's an interesting dynamic. I think at this point, you look at this team, like, I think they're still trying to really shore up their identity. That's very apparent. I think they play really hard. I think they give everything they have. And, right now it's starting to trend up for them. But I'm like you. I don't see a run that's going to sustain and it's going to be worth anything. And then you bring up that point about next year, how is this going to help you? Other than Zion Williams, like, is the draft going to be really deep? And then you're picking low because you made the playoffs. You have to be so fine and meticulous with your scouting to get the right players if they're there. So it can be challenging. And I don't know, we don't want to pick up bad contracts, old people who won't really fit what you're trying to mold here too. So you're in a unique situation. But just in the, present time, I don't really see this sustaining. I don't see it sustaining.
They've put themselves in such a hole where – their off-season moves from free agency to the draft to the trade, the re-signs, whatever, they have to work. Like, you have to hit on these. Your draft, whether you draft at number 7 or 17, like, you're going to have to hit on that guy. Mm-hmm. And I'm not saying he has to, be a superstar, but he's going to have to be, at best next year, or at least in the next, couple years, he's at best going to have to be, a role player. Like a contributing role player.
6 or 7 coming off the bench. Right. The worst.
So Luke Kennard's starting to show that, and that's good. But it's going to take a lot more than Lego,
always felt like
Lego legs
touches.
Luke Kennard.
Yeah, he's getting touches now. He's getting rhythm. He's kind of seeing the court now because he's on the floor a lot more. So that helps him. But, geez. Again, I just don't see it. I just don't buy into it. Like I said, it's still hard to watch them as a team,
And Andre Drummond saying, "Oh, the Bulls are a great team." Like, get the fuck out of here! They're like 19-48. Yeah.
And that's a thing too. A lot of us.
I was flipping back and forth, and I kept going to FSD because I thought that's what the Michigan Hockey game was on. It wasn't. It was on FSD Plus. So I kept going to the wrong channel, and then I flipped on FSD right as they were interviewing Andre after the game, and that's the part that I heard was, "Oh, Chicago's a great team." I was like, what are you talking about? No, they're not. Like, you guys beat the Raptors. Okay, different. You beat the Bulls. Like, they don't even have 20 wins right now. Mm-hmm. But the question I want to ask is, do you guys feel like people are more so buying into the Pistons right now because everybody else in this town's trash? The Wings aren't good, the Tigers aren't good, and the Lions aren't good. if the Tigers were still pretty good and the Lions were maybe like 8-8, 9-7, do you think as many people would really be buying into the business?
No, absolutely not. There's not enough to really buy into. You figure we know the Wings are pretty much done for the year. They're in the cellar, you know, and the past couple years with the Tigers have been, you know, hard to watch as well.
Yeah, they've been brutal.
At least right now with the playoff push coming up and the East being so bad and no LeBron James factor in the East, there's this weird chance. And, you know, you got to throw into account, like, you have to play the games. You know, injuries happen, big shots, whatever the case might be. And they are playing well. So it's something to get attached to. But I think the real question is the city really getting behind the Pistons? We're talking about, I don't know.
I think there's a mixed bag of that.
Kind of like us. Like, yeah, but.
Yeah, there's a lot of that. But I think if we put the shoe under the foot with the Lions, everybody would just be drowning in cornbread butter and soaking in that right now. If the Lions were doing something like that right now, that's what that. And I saw, I don't know if you heard me earlier talk about that fan who said the media's no, you heard that earlier. So Lance, there's a guy on Twitter who said that the, I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but the reason why people don't come here is because the media is so hard on the players. That is one of the dumbest things I've ever heard tweeted out.
Pretty weak.
And I think with the Pistons, it is that skepticism that comes with it. I still think there's a lot of, and maybe I'm in a minority with this, but I think there's a small contention who are upset that they moved from the Palace. The people in the northern Oakland County area, because they were selling out really well there with that Palace. So that whole excuse about, well, they're being too far removed from the area was bullshit. Mm-hmm. Total bullshit. But there's a small part of those fans who won't come down to Detroit because they don't want them to come down to Detroit. It doesn't matter if they're good or not, to a certain extent.
Yeah, I mean, there's definitely going to be those group of people. We'll see what the attendance does here the last quarter of the season or whatever we have left, because obviously they are starting to play better. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, it just when you're not playing well, you know, because it shows with the Wings too. I mean, it's not like for the Pistons it's empty and the Wings it's full. Like, no, they're like the
but
Wings.
How are the Lions pulling that off though? You know what I mean?
Because it's football.
This is a football town.
Yeah,
because it's football. A football town.
Well, then why is every hockey fan? Oh, this is
because
they're
in denial. It is hockey town. That's fine, but this is a football town.
Yeah, like, those fans are in denial
before anything. And then too,
you get eight football games though every year.
And then with the Pistons, how about this though? When they were out in Auburn Hills, like when they were winning, people from the city were making the drive because the product was worth watching.
Yeah.
That's really the biggest factor. With, you know, the location and everything. Like, I can understand someone from northern Oakland County saying, like, I'm not driving all the way downtown, getting caught in that traffic these fucking two-lane roads right here on the corner of Wereverville and, you know, to see a bad product. I get that. But you're not going to tell me, like, oh, it's the arena. That's a beautiful arena down there. They kind of rushed it, but it's a beautiful arena.
Right.
You know? It's the product. The product is crap.
You guys see that article, though? It was in Cranes, or hear about it, how the District of Detroit isn't really living up to, not the arena, but just the whole block itself hasn't really lived up to expectations as of yet. They haven't, like, the development hasn't really become what we were promised as of yet.
It's still in developing stages, but it won't until the teams, at least two of the teams, are legitimately in the chase, you know, for rings. You know, go back 5 years. If you drop LCA right where it is right now, bring both teams down during the middle of the Tigers push, you'll get more tickets to the basketball games. It's something about the energy down there.
Probably the cold weather, too.
That, too. Like, come on.
I just hate that cold weather. I mean, like, I wouldn't go down there because the teams are trash. That's pretty much it for me. I mean, it's not – I totally understand that the arena is probably very nice, but I'm not going to drive down there on a Tuesday night, pay $20, $15, $20 for parking, walk in the cold to go watch the Pistons lose, like, by 20 to the Raptors.
How about this? If the Lions played in an outdoor stadium, do you think they would sell out?
Yes.
Yeah, I think they would. Absolutely.
Football's different.
Yeah.
I mean, a football town.
Yeah. There might be games where it might not look completely full. I'll give you that. And, like, fans might leave sooner, like, if they're getting blown out or something, because obviously it's different sitting in a 70-degree controlled climate as opposed to 20-degree snowing, like, freezing your ass off. But, no, yeah, I still think relatively speaking, they'd sell out every game.
And that's how you know, like, you know, the Detroit Pistons fans, they're not really diehard fans. That's my opinion. I've never thought that Pistons fans were diehard fans, you know?
No, I
think between
that.
The Tigers and the Lions, that's where our fan base is. The Wings at times can be kind of, you know, fickle.
I think the Lions, obviously, as we've all kind of just hinted at, the Lions have the most diehard fans. They also have the most dumb fans because they're diehards. But then, I think the battle for second, honestly, I'd probably say the Red Wings.
You think so?
Our number two, yeah. I'd probably say the Red Wings, Tigers, and then Pistons.
Okay, and maybe what I'm seeing is because, again, summer weather, people make the drive to come see Tigers game, whether they're good or bad. You know, like, they will come down to the ballpark.
Yeah, especially like the night games too. Especially you get those Thursday day games. Yeah, when the Tigers are bad. Yeah, I mean you could you know count how many people are there. But
well, how about when they're in the chase? Like a day game is sold out.
Oh yeah,
screw work.
Yeah, when the Tigers are good, that place
shows up.
Yeah. So I feel like with the Wings, it's not. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe we need to look at the attendance numbers. But I feel like when the Wings aren't that good, their attendance doesn't seem as bad as the Tigers does. But like I said, maybe the numbers tell a different story. We'd have to look that up. So we'll take a break here in a few minutes anyway. So we'll look in a few minutes. In a few minutes. Because I want to end on this. I found this morning, and it'll kind of tie up. With baseball and whatnot. So Manny Machado, who signed with the Padres, is sort of taking on the role of being a villain in baseball. But the problem is he says he doesn't know why, and that's where I don't know why he doesn't see that. So Machado told the New York Post in a story, I always will be the villain no matter what. I don't know why. That is just stuff I have to deal with, and I have been okay dealing with that situation. That doesn't bother me. I'm going to play my game and I am going to go down as a player I am. I can't control what people think of me. I can't control any of that. I can control what I do on the field. I can control how good of a teammate I am, how good of a player I am. I'm not going to say that I don't regret some of the things I have done. I've done some pretty dumb things, not going to lie. I see the things I've done and I've done some dumb things. Yeah, you just said that. Mm-hmm. At the same time, I've done things that get blown out of the water and suddenly I am that guy. At the end of the day, I play baseball and I don't let anything else get in my head. So obviously, as we all remember last year in the playoffs, there was a couple moments where Manny Machado didn't exactly hustle. Mm-hmm. And so he was criticized for it. And he told reporters, quote, he is not the type of player that's going to be Johnny Hustle. But there's also a couple other instances. There's the incident. Last World Series when he stepped on Red Sox first baseman Steve Pierce's heel while running through first base. And then a similar incident happened in the NLCS. So, guys, I don't understand why he's so baffled by being labeled as a villain. Like, you admitted you don't hustle, which is, as an athlete, a cardinal sin.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, in the commandments of athletes, that is one of them. You never admit to not hustling. Like, I'm not saying you have to hustle on every play, but for the love of God, don't ever admit you didn't hustle. And then he stepped on a couple of first basemen's feet. Like, I know it sounds a little stupid, but you could seriously injure somebody doing that. And you don't see that every game. That's not something that's a common occurrence. Like, bro, it happened twice in, like, 2 weeks for you. Like, that's kind of a red flag.
Yeah.
Do you guys truly think he's a villain? And, I mean, do you see his point of, like, asking, like, why? Why am I a villain? I don't understand that. Like, where do you guys stand on that? I mean,
what else is he supposed to say, you know?
Yeah, I'm a dick.
He's like, next question. You know, but...
Right.
Yeah, it's hard to argue what we see on the television screen. You know,
might like, be a dick, but my hustling. Contract still says $300 million.
I don't know. Like, this isn't a situation where the contract is, you know, people have a sour grin. Oh, he shouldn't be making that much money and blah blah blah. Like, these are incidents, like you said, that can seriously hurt people, and you're doing it on purpose. You know, one time is like, you can tell watching the baseball game because of the pace of the game if something's done on purpose, i.e. A-Rod slapping a whole glove out of the first baseman's hand.
Right.
You
know, what? My arm was just
flailing.
Oh,
it's totally crazy.
Yeah.
I was waving
big
high.
Big old white mitt just whoosh. But you can see that. We could all see him doing that. We can see you not hustling, too. You know, and he's not the only player in the majors who doesn't hustle.
No, and there's probably there's a lot, trust me, out of a 162-game schedule for every team every player, there's tons of instances.
Yes.
Hey, I love Miguel Cabrera as much as an ex-Tigers fan. There's plenty of instances he doesn't run out of ground ball.
Yep. But when you sign contracts like that and when your name is floating around as one of the best players in the league, the spotlight is going to be on you.
Right.
I think you just have to be a little more responsible about, you know, how you address that. You can't be frivolous with it or careless with it. You know, maybe you don't fully acknowledge the not hustling thing, but, you know, you got to really own that whole stepping on people's foot and just really being a crappy person. That's really what that is. It sounds like he's a little bit entitled and that he doesn't think that, you know, rules apply to him.
Right. But, yeah, no, it's – like you said, you step on someone once, it's kind of like, oh, okay. Even if it looks like you did on purpose, like it's still kind of like, okay, you did it once. You do it twice, especially in like that time span. It's not like you did it once in April and then you did it again in like September.
Let's just be honest. Like you play sports, you know. Everybody's taking a cheap shot at somebody.
Right.
At one point, you know, frustration, whatever the case might be. Like maybe just to knock a guy off his pedestal a little bit, let him know like, hey, you know. But you don't do it consistently.
Right.
You don't do, that makes you a jerk.
So $300 million.
He's going to be the bad guy.
Yeah. There's that point, too, where you have to kind of realize that your actions, you got to be more and more, like, if you're blissfully unaware, sure, but come on. Mm-hmm. You know, don't bullshit.
Are you guys surprised you signed with San Diego?
I'm not.
They offered him money.
That's exactly what I was going to say, Lance.
And then based off, you know, what the accusations are, he's like, man, let me just feed my family. Let me be great, you know? He's going to go out there. He's going to hit 25 home runs.
Trick love the kids.
He's going to play good. That market's not going to expect a lot of him.
Right.
He's got it made. Beautiful city, you know?
Yeah,
San Diego's a phenomenal.
Yeah. I think it's like, the most expensive housing market in the country, I think.
You don't have to worry about that.
Like, yeah, no, I know, but like,
three rooms or two.
Yeah, no, but, but like for a 3-bedroom house, you pay, for example, in Redford, you probably pay close to $800,000 in San Diego. Mm. That's the kind of like inflation we're talking about here. Like, so $60,000 here, oh, sweet, you get a 3-bedroom house, nice ranch, possibly. San Diego, $60,000 will get you maybe an apartment for a 1-room apartment you have to share with a roommate.
Yeah.
Just. No, but no, and they're in a situation. The Padres right now, he's the biggest thing that's ever happened to San Diego. Mm. Because San Diego, Padre-wise, outside of Tony Gwynn, what do you know about the Padres? Nothing.
Nothing.
They went to 2 World Series. They lost to the Yankees in 98.
I forgot about that.
Yeah, me too.
Wow, that was the first 3 straight wins, right, for the
Yankees? Yeah, that was, yeah.
I
that
forgot
was,
about that.
Yeah, Sterling Hitchcock was their ace. That was the Andy, I think Andy Bennis was on that rotation. Yeah, exactly.
Wow, I forgot.
Yeah, I knew you would get that reference. And, of course, he lost 84 to the Tigers. But they didn't have – I think they still don't have a no-hitter. Mm. I think that they're one of the few teams that don't have a no. I have to double-check that. But the Padres were owned by Ray Kroc, who owned McDonald's. Mm-hmm. They've had a colorful history. The Chargers, you know, gone. Colorful history is a good way to put it.
Yeah.
But they've been inept. They changed jerseys a lot, too. Like, they've gone through a lot of jersey changes.
Sometimes they feel like a sideshow.
That's because their team sucks.
Didn't they have, like, army fatigue?
You know? Yeah. Well, yeah, because of the bases, which makes sense.
Yeah. But still baseball.
But it's kind of minor league baseball-ish kind of, like, draw to that. But, no, he is the big fish in a relatively, I think, you know, quote-unquote small market. Because if he was staying in L.A., he would not have gotten all the attention. Now he goes there, and I think it's the same thing why Bryce Harper's on with Philly. They gave him the most money, the deal that's going to help him out the most. But for the Padres, they're maybe a year or two away. But they have some really good minor league talent. Fernando Tatis Jr. has been hitting it really well. They have one of the top five, if not one of the best farm systems of all baseball. But it's really what they're going to do with it. But, I mean, until – I'll be honest with you, like, even as much as I love baseball, I couldn't tell you three Padres off the top of my head.
No. Well, Myers.
Yeah, that was it. Myers, and they had a...
Was Moustakas on the team last year?
No.
2 years ago?
No.
3 years ago?
No. Why would you ask? Why would you think Moustakas was on that team? He was with the Royals the entire time until he signed with the Brewers. Is that right?
I'm looking this
up. Yeah, look that up real quick. And you want to go to break?
Yeah. So while I look that up, we're going to take a quick break on the other side of the break. We're going to talk less sports. I want to talk about the plot of Pearl Harbor and how effed up it is.
Yeah, when I saw it on the show, I was like, fascinating.
Yeah. And then, yeah, so we'll talk about that more. Come up next on Mitten Sports Talk right here on Sports Radio Detroit.
Well, don't forget to talk about our friends over at Advanced Auto Center in Redford. We can't tell you how happy they are. They're the official sponsor of Mitten Sports Talk. You can find them at 25167 8 Mile Road in between Beachdale and Telegraph. Great deals right now, especially with pop holes right now. 4.8 out of 5 on Google. That's strong, okay? That's strong in terms of, from SureCritic. I'm sorry. 4.6 on Google Reviews. Still, either way, good stuff. They'll give you great service, fast, and the mechanics are very efficient. They will not BS you around. They won't put stuff you don't need. So
Eric Hosmer
is you thinking of. Thank you. Yes. I was going to say, I'm like, Moustakas, what?
Courtesy of my father. But yes, all right. Eric Hosmer.
That's Thank you, Mr. Royal. Silver. Thank you, Mr.
That's
Silver.
That's the Royal I was thinking of, yes.
So find them over in off Beach Daily in between Telegraph and Beach Daily, 8 Mile Road between Beach Daily and Telegraph. And give them a call, 313-535-0500. Tell Mint Sports sent you, and you get 20% off any service. Now is the time. Get your car springed up. Get ready for summer. Summer is just around the corner. Spring's next week, but I always got to think long term of summer. Get some new tires. Get your windshield wipers all fixed up, and they'll take care of that for you.
Evie and Kinsler, too.
Yeah, there you go. Oh, yeah, the Padres do. Not in Advance Auto Center. Advance Auto Center, Redford, your place for a great deal.
All right. Welcome back. Mitten Sports Talk right here on Sports Radio Detroit. So before we move on to our next topic, I just kind of wanted to get this to mention this. So as you guys know, here at SRD, we cover broadcasting for a couple of high school hockey teams, one of them which being Salem. And they had their state quarterfinal game on Wednesday, and they took on Detroit Catholic Central, who's just a effing monster. And CCA has only lost once this year, and it was to the number 3 team in the nation, Academy School from Indiana. So they haven't lost to anybody in the state, and they still haven't as of today. And a lot of people kind of expected CC to handle Salem pretty well. And so they played on Wednesday, and Salem played them very well, and CC ended up only winning 1-0. And yeah, CC had a lot more chances than Salem for sure. I do not have the official shot statistics for the shots on goal, but I would be a pretty safe bet. CC outshot them by quite a bit, and Salem just kept strong with them, and they were skating with them. They were playing them physical. They were hitting them, and Salem got a handful of their own chances as well, and it was just it was incredible, because a lot of people did not expect that game to go that way. A lot of people expected Salem to get beat pretty badly, and so I just want to, as the season has now ended with that loss, I just kind of want to give kudos to that Salem hockey team, because they surprised a lot of people in that game, including myself. And as a guy who has seen most of their games and knows CC the way a lot of us do as being a power. I mean, CCA, Catholic Central has been in the state championship like 6 of the last 7 years. So, and obviously they've won a handful of those. So it was really cool to see Salem kind of go toe to toe, punch for punch with the big dog. And, so yeah, I just wanted to mention that. I know, unfortunately, all 3 of our teams lost: Ann Arbor, Gabriel Shard, Livonia Stevenson, and Salem. So, Yes. Very unfortunate. But
yes, very, very unfortunate.
But yeah, so but no, it was really cool to see Salem do that. So kudos to them for making that happen. And I know I know Coach Ostermacher and his staff were really happy with their team's performance. Obviously, you know, you always want to come out with a win, but no, that was, if there was any way to end your season in the state tournament, that would be one hell of a way to do it, is going, like I said, punch for punch with probably the best team in the state, if we're being honest with ourselves. So good for those guys. And next year, you know, there's good things to come for next year for all three of our teams and possibly beyond that. So we'll let you guys know more about that later. Also, another, I guess, side note that we should probably mention here on Mint Sports Talk for SRD is...
By the way, though, honestly, to get back, piggyback your Plymouth thing, great job by those guys. They only lose 1-0 like that to a CC team that, offensively speaking, has averaged about 4.5 goals a game all season. Five.
Yeah, their goal differential was, on average, like 5.3 to like 1.
Yeah, and so, even like their second, I know in the second period, they like the outscore their opponents was an insane number. I forgot
it was
the number.
Like 53 to 11.
Yeah.
First period is like 48-8.
And not to mention the Salem fans, I want to give a lot of credit to the Salem fans because honestly, there's times where they crash their website for how many times they come to the game after the game. So kudos to people who on the Salem side of things have come around and subscribed to the work that Jeremy's done. And Jeremy, good. That game-winning call in the regional, that was one of the best calls I've heard, and the fans agreed with that, and they made it part of a video. So I really like that. That was something that I know Jeremy is not one of those people who likes to talk about himself too much, but I will, as friend and producer, been doing this for a while, to see the kind of response that the Salem fans have had to you and everything, that says a lot about the way you go about it, your laid back approach and everything. And there's people that kind of go over the top with their approach and everything. And that was not you. And honestly, that was, you know, here's the call, by the way. And I have that call because I pulled it up.
The German, his shot got through everybody. Loose puck. Puck goes loose and score! And Salem wins it!
Sorry about that.
And Logan Soa with the game winner, 3 minutes into overtime. And Salem will be the Regional 8 champions and move on to the quarterfinal.
I love doing those things. Those are called audiograms, yeah. Yeah, even Marquise from Fanarchy gave you some props. So
yeah, I did see that. So I definitely appreciate Marquise for that. And Sean Belichin had some kind words to say to me, yeah. So I definitely appreciate that as well. And yeah, and all the Salem fans that listen in, you know, there are a lot of Salem fans that listen in and game out. And I know, it's not a contest, and I know I may get a little flack for saying this, but, Salem fans, out-listen our other teams.
That's what I said.
So they do a really good job and we certainly appreciate that. And we'll definitely be happy to be back next year. So, all right, to move on from one sappy comment to another. So when I got home on Saturday, Pearl Harbor was on, the movie with Ben Affleck and Josh Hartnett, who's just dropped off the face of the planet. And I'm a big history buff, so I do enjoy catching that movie from time to time. But this time it really started to kind of hit me like the plot, the romance part of the plot. So for those of you who know, just sit tight for a second, because there's probably people out there who have never seen Pearl Harbor, don't really know the movie plot. So Ben Affleck is in the Army along with Josh Hartnett, and they're fighter pilots. And Ben Affleck meets a nurse in the Army, and... you know, they hit it off and start dating and whatnot. And then before Pearl Harbor actually happens, the event, Ben Affleck goes to Europe to fight the Germans alongside the British. and he gets shot down. And obviously, this is, you know, back in the 1940s. There's no cell phones or, you know, it's hard to communicate across, like, the oceans and whatnot. So they just think he died. And time goes on, and Josh Hartnett, who's Ben Affleck's best friend in the movie, consoles the nurse and starts dating her. And they fall in love and blah, blah, blah. Well, shockingly, plot twist, Ben Affleck is not dead, and he comes back to realize that his best friend and his ex-girlfriend are now in love and dating again. And obviously, they kind of fight about it and whatnot, and then Pearl Harbor happens. So obviously, they had kind of had to squash that beef quickly. But then after, they're still buddies, and everybody's all cool with each other and whatnot, and it just kind of made me...
What a twist!
And it just kind of made me think, like, would that go over so smoothly in real life? Like, I get those are very traumatic events we're talking about. Like, you went over to fight World War II, and you were perceived to be dead. And then you come back and realize that your best friend and girlfriend are now in love. And then Pearl Harbor happens, which was another very traumatic event.
What a twist!
And so you kind of have to, like, put that aside for the minute so you can, you know, so you can fight the Japanese. But even after all that's said and done, doesn't that seem kind of effed up that they're just all cool about it? I feel like in today's age, that would not go as smoothly. Even with those traumatic events happening, I feel like that would still not go over so smoothly.
I would imagine not.
Bullshit. That's how I feel. Total fucking bullshit.
Gonna have to agree with him. Because I think what it reveals is that you didn't have my best interest in mind from Jump Street. You couldn't wait. You know what I mean? And maybe that's the ego talking. It's like, hey, you know, I went over here. Your eyes were on her already. Then you got word that I went down. Oh, yeah, I'm gonna move in now. And then I catch you with your hand in the cookie jar.
Well, we thought you were dead, bro.
You know what I mean?
Right. That's,
nowadays, this would be all over Twitter, and, you know, this guy would be land-based. Like,
honestly, man, I feel like, and I don't know, maybe it's just me. I've never gotten that vibe from my friends about anybody I've ever dated or they've dated. Like, to have that mentality to snoop in. And I hear this more and more among other people I know. Where I had a buddy, and this guy I played baseball with, his friend dated every single girl that after he broke up with him. And it's so weird. And so I always feel like this is kind of like in the background, in your mind, this is a kind of like some of your friends, this is playing in their head a little bit. Like, you mess up, and they're ready to just be that,
yeah,
you know.
And you must have good friends, because I've experienced it.
Really?
Well, and I don't want to go too far down memory lane. I was hoping to keep it, though. Like, you know, they thought he died.
So I understand that.
It's fair, but it's like there's being there for her, not moving in with her.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, like, moving in on her.
Right.
Know? So, you know, you want what you want, but I think there's an element of, like, I'm waiting on this guy to screw up. Is that a real friendship then? You know, sorry, I got caught up.
Yeah, and he's just walked away and he's just still going. So,
I don't know. I think there have been moments where I've recognized, maybe not even friends, but close enough associates who are just kind of sitting back in the cut and waiting, like, to come in. Send a hey, everything's gonna be all right text to your girlfriend or something like that. And, you know, how do you defense against it? You know, everybody wants to. Guys don't mind being, you know, friend zone because of that. You know, maybe they can do something that'll get themselves out of it with a couple slick comments and a hug. You know, just knowing they can capitalize on your mistakes. I don't see this as being so far off, but I think in this day and age, it'll get called out quicker.
Right. You know? Well, yeah, and obviously today's age would have a much, much worse impact on things, you know, with social media and stuff like that. But
how about this, though? She should have been held accountable as well.
Right.
You know, because
exactly.
She never once said, well, that was your best friend. Like, I'm not doing that. Like, right. What is your standard?
Well, you know, Lance, it was the 1940s. We weren't as equal back then, so. But, hey, it's true. But,
But no, you're absolutely right. You're absolutely right. But I don't know. I just thought that was like, I just thought that was odd to me. Like now that I'm older and I kind of like see more of the movie than just like, you know, the action scenes. It was just kind of, I'm just sitting there watching. I'm thinking like, that's kind of fucked up. I don't know if I could just like be friends with him. But then, of course, he dies. The friend who fell in love with his friend's girl, he died. So, you know, hey, it all worked out.
Sorry.
Because that's what makes it more messed up. So Pearl Harbor happens. They both make it out. They're all cool. They're buddies again. Then they go on the first mission to Japan. And then the friend dies. And then plot twist, the girl was pregnant with Josh Hartnett's kid. Mm-hmm. And so they come back from their mission to Japan. Hartnett's dead.
What a twist.
Exactly. A lot of twists here. So they come back from Japan. Hartnett's dead. And guess who's waiting for the tarmac? Ben Affleck. And then her and Ben Affleck get back together. And she has Josh Hartnett's kid.
You wouldn't have done that?
Isn't that super? Got back with her after that? Does the kid make a difference?
Whatever you feel.
What am I?
What do you feel?
Hey, whatever you feel. Like, if that's a deal breaker to you, it's like, that's a deal breaker to you. He's like doing them like 300. Because
when they're a party, you feel like, because when they're a party, you feel like that should be my kid. And in a way, it would be your kid because you would be the father figure in its life, and your name would probably be on the birth certificate. But
and I get it.
It's not your kid.
Yeah, you're like looking side eye at the kid, like because he's asking for more milk. You know what I mean? Not my baby. Figure it out. You know? I don't know. It seems like a thing that back in that time frame was probably not uncommon.
When it comes to 8-month-old Brian, Kiari, you are not...
That the greatest backflip of all time. The greatest backflip of all time. Oh, man, that was great.
Play that again.
Yeah, we could probably just do the rest of the show watching these. If you really...
When it comes to 8-month-old Brian, Kiari, you are not.
Wait, he springs up in the air, and then this. Right here. Woo.
He's like in midair, spinning around, and then off the vert.
It looked like a gymnastics, like doing the floor exercise, you know, when they do that part where they do the kick and he jumps into
never
that.
Never missed a beat.
Yeah, never missed it.
No, this is definitely more going. Of a visual joke.
Yeah, yeah.
So, but, no, we can.
Okay.
Sir, one you more.
Want him gets to be smarter, don't you?
Yes, I do. He's a good dad. I see him all his other kids now. He's a good dad.
When it comes to Kiki... Sir,
do you love me?
You are not the father.
And he got a shirt done.
Bruh.
By the way, Maury Povich used to be a respected journalist. And then when he realized this was going to be...
Jerry Springer was a mayor of a... Of
Cincinnati.
Of a big city. He wasn't the mayor of, like, some small hick town. In southern Michigan, like he was a respected mayor of a metro.
They found their lane, man.
Yeah. They found their lane, yeah. But you know, he was married to, I think he's still married to Connie Chung. You know that?
No, I did not know that.
Yeah. Mary Povich, once a respected journalist.
Is he the father of your children? Is he not the
that conversation?
You know what's fucked up too is we're laughing about this and like that 8-month-old child is just sitting there wide eyed with a smile on his face and his well, it's not his parents, because apparently the guy was not his father, but...
Yeah, no, it's...
We are a bunch of fucked
this
up...
This is a messy show.
It's yeah. We are some degenerate people.
I don't know. That's a unique plot twist, though. I'm surprised you picked that up. But...
It was hard not to I on think the it's, I think it's, 15th time I've saw it.
I think it's far more common, though, you know? Far more common. Like, I've had girls tell me, like, I'm dating someone. They're like, yeah, that's not going to work out. And I'll be here. That's strange.
What about girls? What'd you say?
Well, I'm just thinking, like, these are
And guys, too. But, mm-hmm. you know, there are girls, you know, who they're interested, but they know that you're seeing someone.
Mm-hmm.
And they're like, yeah, that's not going to work out.
I've had that happen.
You see what I mean?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Oh, I thought you cared about it. Yeah, I do. But that's not going to work out. And now that's in the back of your head, and you're like, well, you said,
yep.
come here, baby.
So. Oh, yeah. There is a, I'll share that off there. But,
gotcha.
Yeah.
You guys have a couple of friends or a friend that is dating someone that when they first started dating them, you thought, not a chance this will last, and yet they're still together.
Yes. There's a few, but.
And like every once in a while, you think to yourself, like. How?
Like, how are you guys still together?
Yeah, there's one case where within 3 months after one of my buddies started dating this girl, mm-hmm. she was getting confirmed. And I'm like, and I told my other buddy, I'm like, well, she's going to marry him. And he's like, no. I'm like, who starts dating somebody and then suddenly wants to, in their early 30s, want to get confirmed? Unless there's a reason behind it. And sure as shit, I called it right on, like, within a year. You're in your 30s, you're single, and you have no children. Your biological clock is ticking.
Mm-hmm.
Go. Well. So, but there was a buddy of mine who, it was so bad, but he kept, it was the point where, it got really kind of to the point where we had to, like, he's in jail for it. He's literally in jail for it.
Wow.
He's in jail for it, and, it was bad news from day one because his now, well, I'm not sure what's going on the status is, but without giving any names, essentially he married her after 4 months of dating. They got a couple of tattoos. And when he was in jail the first time, because he went to jail for something that had nothing to do with it, she was on a internet website getting somebody used, let's just say, a video that's not a cool video. Let's just mm-hmm. say that. And he got out, and he went back with her. And now he's back in jail for the next 3 years.
Mm.
And everybody warned him. And his family told him, if you talk to her again, we're going to not talk to you. We're not going to help you. We're going to cut you off completely. He's like, okay.
So, like, is he in love? You know what I mean?
Yeah. He's just stupid. No,
sounds like a dumb question. I don't know.
This show has taken a very
big time U-turn here.
Yeah. Dark path.
Are we, I guess. Is there a sports topic we could get back to? Because this show has just taken such an odd twist.
This is what the people care about.
Yeah.
Gossip.
We're going to be Wendy Williams over here. No. I hope,
you know,
God, no.
You know what's funny, though, is you talk about, you mentioned it's what the people want. I don't really watch The Bachelor. Mm. Autumn's mom watches it, so, like, if we were over there at the right time, you know, sure, I'd sit down and watch it. But, like, I don't watch it myself. But, like, because I think The Bachelor's on Mondays, every, like, Tuesday or Wednesday morning, Yahoo has, like, this big, like, update. Recap article, and I feel obligated to read it every time.
Really?
Yeah, because, like, it's just, like, you read it, and it's just, like, damn. You know, like, there's a lot of...
You think it's just kind of keeping up with what's going on?
Yeah, like, but there's, like, a lot of shit that happens. Like, it's not just, like, oh, Becky kissed our bachelor, Matt, and then they went to the fantasy suite, and then the next day, Jennifer had a nice date with our bachelor, Matt. Like, no, it's like, Becky called Jenna bitch, and then, like, Jen dumped our bachelor, Matt, and our bachelor, Matt, like, went crazy, and... You know, like, it's just...
This is, like, real life for some people, though. Like,
but then, like,
shows.
You actually watch the show, and it's just, like, how do you guys... Like, doesn't seem like real life.
People aren't living that way. Like, they're living that life, that constant, like, bickering and being in gossip and mix and stuff like that. And they think that's life.
But it's not.
Well... I guess it's
and then especially in today's age, you got the people that are on there just to get their 15 minutes and just so they can get their spinoff, you know, because that's the thing. Like now with The Bachelor, there's The Bachelor, The Bachelorette, The Bachelor in Paradise. It's like almost like the real world. Like it started off the real world. Then you had the challenges. Now you got 400 different challenges, you know.
They're going to come up with a Bachelor Network.
They should.
They should.
It'll probably do better than the Big Ten Network.
It really isn't. It really isn't a terrible show.
Like, I'm not going to sit here and try and be one of those, like, manly, masculine guys. Like, I would never watch The Bachelor. Like, it really isn't that bad. It's just, like, I don't go out of my way.
I just think it's amazing how people get hung up on it.
Yeah, yeah.
Really, like, shut the house down.
Right.
It's 9 o'clock.
Right.
It, really, for any show. Like, you know what I mean?
No, you're exactly right. Like, you know, and again, I don't, even when we would watch it, like, we could easily enter the room and leave the room at any time.
Yeah.
And I wouldn't necessarily care. But it is a fascinating show. The reality shows are so fascinating.
I will say this. I'm a fan of Naked and Afraid.
I've never watched that show. I don't watch a lot of reality. I'm the minority here with you guys. I don't watch a lot of reality TV. My wife.
I don't either, but.
My wife loves reality TV.
Naked and Afraid is intriguing because.
It does sound intriguing, though.
You know, you look at some of these people and they're exposed for what they don't know, first and foremost. And then they're dropped off in the middle of nowhere with no skills. And it makes you look at yourself like, what would I do in that situation?
Die.
Come get me.
Die.
They're like, yeah, you can pick between, like, a lighter,
a shoelace, knife,
right, like a pack of bubble yum.
This deflated football.
And they're going to drop you out here for 28 days. And by the way, everything out here is poisonous. Have fun. Bye. What do you do?
Die.
You know?
I would not live. I wouldn't be naked and afraid very long. I'd be naked and dead.
Well, it's interesting.
It's like this, pretty much. If it wants to load, now it doesn't want to load.
I was going to say, are we watching another Maury video? I'll see how that ties in.
Oh, this should be good.
MacGyver smoker is a very handy guy to have around, especially when it comes to reefer.
Hey, man, we're out of papers.
All right, then get me a toilet paper roll, a corkscrew, and some tinfoil.
We don't have a corkscrew.
All right, then get me an avocado, an ice pick, and my snorkel. Trust me, bro, I've made bongs with less. Hurry up.
That's how it is when I'm riding the Naked and Afraid. But I got a leaf, a paperclip.
And an empty Mountain Dew bottle.
I'm gonna make camp out of this.
Yeah. Like, damn it, you lost the Mountain Dew bottle? Right. How'd you lose it?
The only reason I have the Mountain Dew bottle is because the pilot finished it on the way down.
Like, wait, it's like,
he threw it out the window at me and said, here, this could help.
He had
go to hell.
One job. Do not lose the Mountain Dew bottle. And he lost it. What are we gonna do?
Fine. Just give me then one of those leaves over there, a army of red ant fire ants. Yeah.
It's something else, man. It's interesting because, you know, it's usually a male and a female, which that's weird. You know, the first night it's like, yeah, we keep checking each other out, right?
Because they don't know each other, right?
Not at all. And they come from various backgrounds. And then, you know, usually the woman is more equipped to kind of, you know, become flexible and make adjustments. And the dude is like a know-it-all asshole type.
Right.
Right? Yeah, but then he gets undone by some, like, you know, oh, I didn't expect it to rain. And, you know, I used my one lighter and I can't find it, and she's undressing him like a wife, like, because you're in a relationship now, like, right. We gotta partner up,
right?
I swear it's interesting. It's interesting to watch.
Wasn't there a show on MTV or VH1 where you like went out on dates with strangers naked?
I don't know about naked, yeah. But there's a show now where it's like couple swapping, and like the girlfriends are like, yeah, he's gonna pick her because that's his type and blah blah blah. And then he does something totally different. And it's crazy. Like, the reality TV world is ridiculously.
And there's stupid shit that like we could sit here and come up with, and we would think like that sounds dumb.
Yep.
But people would watch it.
Who's that, Roger?
Oh, I don't know. Just was randomly scrolling through Twitter. Jordan Woods.
Oh, the infamous.
Yeah. I don't know what idea what it is.
He's out of the loop.
Yeah. But no, it's the only reality TV show I guess I would like that I guess I would watch by accident is my wife watches Dr. Pimple Popper, and it's just a girl, just a woman who literally just popping zits off people, and that is fascinating to me only because how the hell are you not taking care of your face and let your skin regimen get that bad?
I was just asking somebody about that. Like, I find that stuff intriguing, like to go in and pull like 75 pounds of matter out of someone's cheek.
Yeah. Yeah, or like...
You know, like you go in and find, like, you know, whole cockroaches in people's ear because, you know, it, this stuff is real, though. And it's disgusting, but
the blackheads too, like, oh, man.
Like, I'm sitting there like this, though, like, cringing, but, like, what's coming next? What's coming next? Like,
right.
I can sit there and watch that all day.
The reality shows, I've kind of gotten into more of the housing shows, like Property Brothers, Fixer Upper. So the problem with those, though, sometimes, like, you get in, like, you can't really binge watch them because a lot of times they're the same shit. Mm-hmm. Like Property Brothers, like every, not every house is the same, but the way they set up most houses are the same. You know, the open floor space, the island in the kitchen, you know, like, so it's kind of like, you know, it's coming. There's this unforeseen, you know, unfortunate circumstance, like a, electrical system is out of date, or, oh, hey, by the way, now that we're 3 months into the project, we realize you might need a new roof. You know, it's just like, it's the same shit, just over and over. It's a different couple, different house, different neighborhood.
Yeah, that's all it is.
Okay, well, this was not the same episode or same show as we normally have. This was an interesting one. But we're going to end it there as I have some work to do now.
You seem so enthused.
No, I'm not. I'm really not. This is becoming the least favorite part, which we'll talk more about.
Yeah.
All right. So thank you for listening. You can always go to sportsradiotrait.com, check out all of our written content and archived shows. Don't forget the Detroit Female Personality Contest is coming out in a few weeks. So we can, and it kind of coincides with Women's International Women's Day was yesterday. And, you know, it's a great way for us to promote the wonderful and talented women in the media profession in this area, which there's a ton of, We can all, you know, go down the list. There's a ton of talented people in this industry, and a lot of them are women. So definitely go to sportsradiodetroit.com when the polls and the brackets come out, and vote on your favorite one. Go to Podbean, Stitcher, the iTunes podcast app, iHeartRadio, pretty much anywhere you go to listen to your favorite podcast, and just type in Sports Radio Detroit in the search bar and you'll find us. I want to thank Lance for stopping by. As Lance will be around a lot more often now. And we will be back next week.
Yeah, same bat time, same bat channel.
This isn't the Roadshow Rider, don't say that.
Yeah, I know. That's right. Come up with something for this.
See ya. Same stupid time, same stupid channel.